got a higher trajectory. The Spirit of God will begin to inhabit you in a fresh way. You'll find yourself having the impulse to say this or do that. It'll be as though a grace is coming with you that'll enable you to do what you never saw yourself doing before. New boldness is coming into your life, says the Lord. And the boldness is infectious. Boldness has an element of joy in it. Boldness makes other people want to know what's going on. It'll make them want to be around you. That enthusiasm, that energy, that joy becomes a pattern interrupt for the world. The Lord says it's going to be as though the darkness gets darker and the voices of a people will be contaminated with the venom of spirits. But you're to be a tongue of healing. You're to be a tongue of enlightenment. You're to be a tongue of joy. Thank you, Jesus. There's a lot of different categories in the Bible. A lot of different people experience different things. But I'm happy I'm a Pentecostal. Thank you, Jesus. Now somebody's going to have to... Oh, I've got bios here. That's what that is. Well, so last night, I was saying, well, this would be different, Lord, what we're doing in Georgia. And we have so many great reformers. Here's what we're putting together here. We're putting together Reformation and Revival. Oh, wait a second. You know what? I think we need to fill up these seats. You see, what we did was, how many of you can sense it's different when you come together physically? When you're physically... See, so you got all these empty seats. Listen, you can come on down now. Come down forward. Don't spread out all over the Mediterranean. You that are back there, I'm going to shut those sections down. Come this way. Because there is a greater power in unity. I might tape these sections shut. Thank you, Lord. You know, there's certain personality types that like autonomy. They like to have space. I'm one of them. But... this is a rugby match, and we need every player connected. Thank you for listening to me, those of you that are listening to me. I know everybody's listening, everybody's doing what I'm saying. It's kind of like the body of Christ. Everybody hears God, and everybody's obeying God, but they're hearing. Now, these seats on the front row, I'm making an executive decision. The VIPs didn't show up, so I need some people in the back to come take the seats of the VIPs. Whoever they are, my wife's name's there. She's somewhere here, I know. We don't need Michelle. Michelle Murillo's not going to be down here. She's going to be with her husband. So let's take these things away and let people come down. Let the ordinary patriot come down and sit where the generals sit. I feel better already. It's like male pattern baldness. I don't like discovering it in an audience or on my head. So I said to the Lord, Lord, I really do, I got a little bit of time. I got only a few minutes, and I know what I'm going to be talking about. What do you want me to say? It's a different kind of a gathering. We're here in the 19 counties that are the most resistant to the gospel, most resistant to revival. Why do I say that? Because the 19 counties that have been picked out of 3,143 in America that are going to determine the future of America have more conservatives and more Christians in them than vote. That's what makes them what we consider high priority counties. Now Philadelphia, I'm from Philly. I wouldn't go to Philly because the elections are stolen. They're gonna vote, they're gonna have 108% of their people are gonna vote, even though only like 30% actually show up. But I'll go to Bucks County outside of Philadelphia because Bucks County and Montgomery County I could fight for. Forget Philadelphia. See what I mean? So here you're around these counties. We came here where we knew there'd be a couple of good churches. That's it. But for the most part, you're an underperforming county. That means that there's more potential fruit on the tree, but the tree needs a shaking or something to get that thing loose. And this is all by faith. Because how is us meeting here in this room with all these chairs going to make a difference? Well, this is the faith part. We're doing what we got to do. Somebody's helping to help underwrite this in part, not in total, which is why I still got to have your help somehow. But we're still doing this in all seven states, because if I want to have a good photo op, I'm going to go to Tampa, I'm going to go to Fort Worth, and I'm going to go to Tulsa. But if I want to have America saved, I'm going to have to go to Montgomery County and Bucks County and Duluth and places where people don't show up. Thank God for you. Thank God for you. And some of you even flew in. Who came from out of state? We need to know who those heroes are. Oh, stop it. Stop it. Oh, my God. Did you guys see that? You deserve something. I swear, as they say in Rhode Island, you guys came from out of state. This is like this is the true patriots. All right, now who... To really feel the challenge of the territory. Who's from Georgia here? Thank God. Well, fear not, little flock. It is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Thank you, Jesus.
We were offered an opportunity to do this in Jensen Franklin's church. It was very nice. Somebody suggested it. And they had just had revival going on in their church. He's going to be speaking next. And I just didn't want to do it because I've been in some of these political rallies, and it's a different kind of a spirit. And I didn't want to bring that right into a sanctuary. I mean, I'm probably old school that way. I like sanctuaries to be for preaching the Bible and worshiping and marriages and things like that. But it was nice, and probably would have had a bunch of his people in the meeting because it would have been easy to do. But I wanted to do this in an atmosphere that is completely outside the church because that's where we're going. And at some point, you can only share tweets with your little, you know, MAGA crowd for so much and then realize you're not changing the world. You're just educating each other or frustrating each other, depending on what you're posting. So I said, Lord, where are we? The Lord says, here's where the church is. And by the way, thank you to my great team for getting me this flip chart. I just call them up. I get panic attacks all the time. And like 10 minutes before the meeting, do you have a flip chart? And they're all running around. Oh, my God, who thought he was going to have a flip chart? He's going to, you know, why would he use a flip chart? Well, because I felt like I may need one. So anyway, in Acts chapter 10, I'm saying to the Lord, where are we? Here's what the Lord says to me. We're a lot like Peter. This is the church. Now, you guys are early adapters. That's good for you. But we're a lot like Peter. God is calling us to do something we've never done before, which is engaging culture. We're not used to this. I mean, everyone that's on the front lines of what God's doing right now is a reluctant soldier. They didn't do that because they were trying to come up with a strategy to build a following on the internet. They did it because an issue impaled them, grabbed them, or took them hostage, and they ended up becoming an advocate or a spokesperson for an idea. And then gradually, people started finding them because they were articulating what needed to be said. We're in the Reformation. Reformation is different than revival. You've heard people praying, oh God, send a revival, send an awakening. I want to suggest to you some things that we need to get educated on. We have to kind of like raise our spiritual IQ on certain subjects, or we're going to lose this country completely. One of them is, you got to recognize it's a minority of people who are actually controlling America. You know, when 9/11 happened, it happened because guys with box cutters with a plan broke through into cockpits, locked the doors, and crashed planes. After that, they barricaded doors. They wouldn't let you know when you want to go to the bathroom. When the pilot comes out and opens the door, they block it up there with their tray. You've all seen the routine if you're a frequent flyer like me and done like 2 or 3 million miles. We learned those things because we discovered how the devil operated. And then we have all this crazy security going. I remember before there was this. This is going to be like telling your grandchildren stuff like they don't have any idea. How many remember an era of time when you could actually go right from the front door all the way to your entrance of the gate with your family, give them a hug, give them a kiss, say goodbye, and get on the plane? It's like you can't describe that to people now. They're getting frisked. They're getting, you know, multiple x-rays scans. If they got a bottle of water, they got to make a big choice. Do you want to return and go drink it? Or you can't even drink it right there. It always struck me as odd that you can't just finish the bottle. But here's the point. When you see how the game is played, you realize a handful of people can take hostage a plane and a handful of people can control the culture. Now, this would drive you nuts when you see this. In the Bible, it says that when we see Satan, it's in Isaiah, he's going to be revealed for who he is, stripped away from the smoke and mirrors and the sound and the bluster. And you'll see the actual power behind the Antichrist. And people will say, is this the man that ruined nations? They're going to see a rather small, pathetic-looking thing. What you see is the power of evil is not because of its size. It's because of its focus. If it wants to destroy something, it can destroy it. That's what makes it powerful. But it's not because of its size. It's not like we're dealing with the whole Third Reich here. We're dealing with a small group of people. So even when you're thinking about who is out there in America, it's kind of hard to pray for the salvation of America if everybody in your mind that isn't like you is a zombified, demon-possessed zealot trying to burn down your car. The reality is it's a small minority of people that are the radicals. But here's the dangerous part. They get the microphone. They get the TV show. Satan promotes them to the point of maximum influence. So remember this. You're never responding to them because they're probably under such a strong spirit, it'll take a St. Paul 2x4 to deliver them anyway. What you're doing is when you're dealing with a lot of people that are in your face, you're dealing with the remnant that are the most radicalized. But they represent a whole lot of people that are under their persuasion. You're actually not dealing with that person. You're dealing with the audience that's watching the interaction. This is really important that you get this. You're not talking to the person who is planted in the audience to debate with you, because they're like, they're taken captive to a higher degree than the average person. Your real audience is the people listening to the exchange between the two of you. We need to realize a minority of people have gotten a hold of the media empires. It's about 10 newspapers or 10 publishing corporations that control 90% of what goes on in media. Same thing with academia. Something has happened. And what's really weird is in the diversity, equity, and inclusion world of what's going on with the universities, they have no diversity, equity, and inclusion. That's all like weird language to put you in a state of hypnosis regarding something you're doing that's going to help people to get minority people that are underprivileged access to rich white people stuff. That's not what's happening. It's isolating conservatives and Christian and heterosexual values that represent the majority and advocating for the minority that are able to destabilize the culture. So what you're going to see is you're going to see the people that have racism, or people that have bizarre sexual deviant tendencies, or you're going to see them promoted to greater and greater opportunities to do what? To be influencers by having positions. If you don't get how the game is played, then you don't realize Satan is, he doesn't have a larger team. He has a more focused team. And what they do in unity. So the university system doesn't have, I think it's now 85% of faculties are liberal, leftist, Marxist, or socialist. That means that you have 50% of America, 65% of America probably, that are conservative leaning strong, that have zero representation in these schools. And it takes a long time for you to realize it, or for your children to realize it, but when they're sending your grandkids into these universities, they're going into propaganda machines. You think they need to get that degree to get ahead. I promise you, the worst thing you could do is put them into that system right now, because the peer pressure, the intellectual spirits, the challenge, the entire environment is designed like Paris Island to destroy their faith. And they'll come out a Marine for the devil if you don't watch it. Does that make sense? So that's just the academic amount. So when they call me up, like the newspapers, well, what do you people want Trump to do in a second term? If he gets in, what deal have you made as Christian nationalists with him? And I really think, I just want to point this out. I think, like, I've taught Seven Mountains. I wasn't going to do Seven Mountains here, but one of the other speakers was going to do it, and I thought, well, you don't need to do it. I'll just do a real quick summary. So here's Seven Mountains. You've never heard it before. It's a real simple picture that, for me, a whole culture is easy to take over. You can capture the flag, starting with the church, if you separate the church from the rest of the culture. Because, see, the only people that really have the truth that can set people free is going to be the Christians. Let me say that again. The only people that have the truth that will actually set you free is the Christian. So the Christian has to go ninja-like or guns a-blazing into every other realm. Otherwise, lies and distortion become normalized. So here's what happens. I said to the Lord, I said, well, what's our verse for today? And here's what the Lord said. Tell them, rise, Peter, kill and eat. I said, why? The Lord said, because they're treating what I've cleansed as though it's unclean. Oh, I had a revelation in a nutshell. So here's Peter around noontime, verse 9 of chapter 10 of the book of Acts, if you're there. He's praying till the sixth hour. And he becomes very hungry. He wants to eat. But while he's hungry, he falls into a trance. Oh, may God give us more trances in Jesus' name. I never had a trance. Lord, I want a trance. I want to fall into trances. Anyway, he falls into a trance and he sees heaven opened up and an object like a great sheet bound at the four corners descending on him and let down to the earth. In it were all kinds of four-footed animals of the earth and wild beasts, creeping things, and birds of the air. And a voice came to him, rise, Peter, kill and eat. And Peter said, oh, no, Lord, for I have never eaten anything common or unclean. The voice spoke to him and said, what God has cleansed, you must not call common. And this man is so dense, God had to repeat it three times. It's not, Peter's always the most religious guy. It's hilarious because he's a cussing fisherman. We all know that about him. But every time he goes into church and gets in the Holy Ghost, he starts acting religious. Oh, Lord, I'm not so, Lord. It's like, oh, come on, Peter. Like, you're so pious. But here's the point. This means that there's whole areas like academia, like media, like entertainment. There's areas where the believers are really uncomfortable going because they feel like they're going into Babylon, into the world territory. You know, the reason why you got one Gutfeld and he's a bit crass and all the other guys are all liberals at night is because these media empires, these entertainment, are populated by people that don't share a Christian worldview. You know, you could be a Christian and still be a comedian. You could be a, which is why I don't like the word Christian nationalist, because in reality, we don't have Christian bands. We have bands or teams of musicians that happen to be Christians. We don't have Christian lawyers. We have lawyers that are Christians. The reason I say that is because when you put the word Christian in front of it, you're creating some kind of a weird, isolated category of endeavor, when in fact God called you to go into all the world so that you could influence all the world, and you can't go into and influence if you're separated from them the moment you get there in your label. Hi, I'm having my Christian Starbucks coffee right now. So what I want you to see here in my goofy little picture is that the left has very shrewdly told us, stay out. This is Andy Stanley, this is Creflo Dollar, and those guys that will, they'll go left, but they won't go right. And so they got this wall here that is like, I'm not in it to win it. I'm not involved with the politics. I'm not trying to dominate it. Well, no, a true Christian isn't trying to beat someone. The only person I'm trying to beat is the devil. And if I have neutrality with the devil, I'm in trouble with God. So here's the deal. Satan comes after that. Satan comes after the family mountain. When BLM did their first website, we got screenshots of it. I should actually blackmail them and hold it hostage and say, I'll give it to you and erase it if you pay me like $100,000. The original website when BLM started was, we are lesbian Marxists against heterosexual normative marriages. We're out for the destruction of the marriage unit as it's presently known. That was the declared proposition of Black Lives Matter in their first website. Then quickly, whoops, scrub it, and then they modified. Then the third iteration, then finally it got Madison Avenue into going to corporations, getting millions of dollars in shakedown money. But the first one was lesbian Marxist destruction of the nuclear family. What? Yes, that was their goal. So what is that? That tells you that the devil is after the family, and he does that through all these different definitions of marriage. And by the way, it's ubiquitous. You go into the arch mountain or the media mountain, the enemy goes and takes it. I'm watching a movie the other night with my wife, and it's a sweet little movie about adopting. So we're looking at different kids that have needs, and we're looking at, but of course, they take every kind. They got a religious couple that's really stupid and a gay couple that's really great. And they write that into the script. So you just kind of, oh yeah, well, gay people are really cool and the Christians are really mean, you know, they're stupid. It's like every dad in a sitcom is always a doofus. And, you know, don't listen to dad. The kid knows more than the dad. And they all roll their eyes because the father's an idiot. Well, what is that? That's the attack that's on the family mountain. Like, you guys get how this goes. You're a sophisticated audience. But what I want you to see is they're coming at me saying, you're about seven mountain dominionism. And here's what I realize. They have already taken the seven mountains. They're afraid we're going to realize what they've done and take it back. They got the church neutralized, the family confused, but this isn't an institution anyway that's organized, except for now we got Jenny Donnelly and others who are going to speak. The mamas are arising in the family mountain saying, hey, get your hands off of my kid. Well, who's coming to get their kid? The entire education system. You have no idea how aggressive this strategy is now, because if they do not, here's how the left works. Somebody else got to understand. It's a minority of people, but they occupy the key positions. So not everybody is agreeing with them. They're like halting between two opinions, but the minority is what's controlling those positions. They know what they're doing. And the only time the left ever stops doing something self-destructive, perverse, or disastrous is when they pay a price for doing it. They don't self-correct. It's not the kind of correction that comes by kindness. Individuals, you win by kindness. Institutions and teams, you have to defeat by strategy. And so you see, unless they pay a price in elections for doing something, just like in the corporate America, you could kind of be forgiving and be tolerant and be loving with Bud Light. The moment you boycott it, you sent a message they understood. Finally, we spoke in tongues they could interpret. Oh, you're taking our money. Well, if you're taking our money, how bad is it? Well, let's go see Target. We're going to have some satanic clothes for children. Bang. How did that work out? Not good. Well, I'm not going to go there. Next thing you know, corporate boardrooms are backing up. Larry Fink is sitting there having a meeting with BlackRock, writing essays. Perhaps we're going to have to reevaluate some of the pace at which we move with the diversity. And, you know, what was going on was the American consumer was saying, see, they don't understand boundaries unless you reinforce a consequence. These are lessons you got to get because there's no one book that has all of them. But they've taken the family mountains, so mama bears are arising. They've taken the church mountains, so patriot pastors have risen, who are capable of staying true to the Holy Ghost, preaching the gospel, and knowing how to adapt the subject matter of the sermons to what's going on in the culture to educate the people and to have them engage in biblical citizenship to go vote and operate in the school boards and occupy certain local offices. This is like the new breed of pastor who's in the minority but saving America. But this is the education mountain. And like I said, the mischief is 85% of the faculty doesn't reflect one half of the nation. That's impossible. You got like 5% in some places, 0% that are actually conservative economists. I'm talking about economics now. I'm not even talking about religion. I'm just saying I have a different theory than spend it. I come from the Milton Friedman School of Finance. All right, government, you know what they've done there. You've seen it. And what you've seen in the FBI, the DOJ, we're all getting a civic. Gene Bailey and I talk about this all the time. I say, you ever notice how we're getting educated? I didn't know about the Electoral College. How many of you are checking out what's going on in Nebraska these days? See, a lot of you don't even know. Joe Biden, theoretically, he could take Arizona and Pennsylvania or Georgia and a bunch of states. But if he doesn't have Nebraska, he'll be denied the ability to be in the White House. So you have to get like 270 electoral votes. It's a possibility that they could end up being tied, Trump and him, with like 168 or something like that, and that the Electoral College would have to go to the House of Representatives, Congress, for a vote. However, what's interesting about this election year is there's more red states than blue states. It's just the blue ones have more electoral votes in them. So if it goes to the House because of a tie, automatically, every state gets one vote, and you're going to have Trump in for 4 years if they're tied. And it's possible that Biden has no path forward. He's relying on an electoral college division in Nebraska, which means that they're going to have a bicameral. For some reason, them in Maine have some goofy thing, which is like Omaha is really big. They get their own two votes, and the rest of the state gets like three, and together they kind of cancel each other out. But they just realized they don't have to do it that way. And it happened at a turning point, of all things, a bunch of young people in their 20s and 30s talking. And they're having a meeting, and one of them said, why doesn't Nebraska just get its act together and get all the votes on one side? Then all the electors are gonna go. If they did that, there'd be no way that you ever see Biden in the White House, for instance. All I'm doing now is a 501c3, by the way, is educating you on political issues. I'm not advocating for anyone in office, necessarily. I'm educating you on how this works. So now Charlie goes out there, and it's so funny because the guy that knows the least about politics actually is my prophet friend, Hank Kuhneman. Hank's great on prophecy, but half the time when the show's over, I'm explaining to him how things work. So I get a call from Turning Point. We need a venue that will be supportive of us coming out. and taking this state and having a meeting. Do you think your friend Hank Kuhneman would let us use his church? I said, I don't know. Let's just try. Anyway, so the turning point goes out, the Lord of Hosts Church, and here's Hank. He's hosting the Taking Back of America, which is hilarious. He's like Mr. Magoo. He just kind of fumbled his way right into the casino and got the lottery. Must never tell him I told you these stories. And so he says, hey, thank you the other night. That was really nice. Thanks for recommending my church. Yeah, okay, make history. Anyway, they're doing it right now. But I'm telling you, it just shows you a bunch of teenagers, 20-year-olds and 30-year-olds talking came up with a discovery. You never know what God's going to do this year. That came out of nowhere. And they're working on it right now. They're fighting over it. Wouldn't you know it's going to be one or two Republicans that are holdouts. This is the other problem we have with America. And I hope some of my other guest speakers address it. We elect people that go up into that environment. Let me finish my illustration here. They go up into this environment here, and they get sucked in under the power of the seduction of the system. Floyd Brown can explain that to us better than anyone else because he's a Washington guy. Something happens. It's in the water. It's in the air. But you realize you got to kind of play the game differently. You may have been kind of like able to run a campaign back in your district at home, but now that you're here, the big boys, the big brothers will take you to the back room and tell you what they're going to do to take care of you, help you out as a beginner or freshman, get you some sweet assignments you're going to have that'll make you so valuable back to your state that you'll get big business backing you because you're on some sweet spot committees. Oh, by the way, every now and then, you know, there's things we know that you don't know. We'll bring you up to speed on them, but we really like to work together. We think you understand that we got to work together. We can't be dysfunctional here. Oh, yeah, okay, I get that. Next thing you know, you're part of the Uniparty. How else did we have the Republicans voting for a $1 trillion every 100 day over expense in the budget? Sent them there to stop, and they just went up there and approved another $2 and $3 trillion. And they think they can get away with it because they think their people are stupid. Anyway, we've got some guys here. I'm going to put them on the stage for a minute. And they're going to share with you. Some of you are going to be called Rise, Peter, Kill, and Eat. You're going to have to go get involved with politics. My suggestion to you is kind of like us taking on a room with, it's good to have faith for a couple of thousand, but the reality is, don't start by trying to be a celebrity in Congress. Start with a humbler office. All my friends that ran for Congress never got in. And some that never should have wanted me to endorse them, and that was embarrassing when I couldn't endorse some of them because I said, why don't you talk to me before you decide to throw your hat in the ring? Doesn't mean that's the ring your hat belongs in. Start learning a little bit. Be humble about it. It's a big deal to serve in government. A state legislator, Senate status is an important role. Prepare for it, but we've got now training for you. So rather than going in and embarrassing yourself and everybody else because you don't know what you're doing, you're all going to have a learning curve. What if we have coaching for you so that if God puts it upon you to rise, Peter, kill, and eat, we're going to show you who to go to get the training so you succeed. Because I'm here to tell you, you're going to hear that knock on the door. There's a number of my friends that are hearing God call them, and it's like, hey, I have to answer the call. And you know, you're not going to feel like it. Here's the beautiful thing. If you are not the kind of person that feels like you could do it, you're even more likely to get called by God. Because then God gets all the glory for that one. Anyway, here's my point. They say we're dominionists and Christian nationalists. They've neutered the church. They've invaded the family. They've taken over education all the way down to your 11 and 12-year-old, getting targeted by queer evangelists who are going into the school system under your tax-paying money with their bloated multi-million dollar organizations to go educate your child in the diversity that's out there, to put a doubt in them as to whether they're a boy in a girl's body or a girl in a boy's body, and then warning them not to talk to their parents. Once you get educated about what's going on, in other words, it's brazen. Let me do the corollary for that. Imagine Pentecostal Lance Wellnow goes and has his team of Christian teachers that decide to bring in a substitute teacher for art class. And this substitute teacher is going to tell them how They're all going to go to hell like their parents when they die, unless they get born again and baptized. But don't trust your family. They don't understand these things, or they would have told you already. And then we're going to have water baptism in the class. And all these kids are suddenly getting water baptized and wearing a special sticker on the back of their neck, which tells them they're going to heaven. That's like the rubber band they give you when you go to these queer classes. Now you're celebrating. If the left saw you doing that, they'd be freaking out. It would be every day, every night. Joy Reid would get out of bed at 4 in the morning to go do that story. They're doing it to your, it's worse. They're gender mutilating your kids for life. If you went out and tried to force convert somebody into your religious belief system, bam, they'd skewer you overnight. Separation of church and state. All right, so what do you got? You've got government taken over by the left, education taken over by the left, family taken over by the left, church neutralized by the left, media, dare I say anymore, media. What I love about Donald Trump, he's the only person, he actually made my Seven Mountains famous, because once he started saying fake news, I'd get off of the plane in other countries, Africa, the Middle East, Indonesia, Singapore. First thing my foreigner international host would say, come to me and go, fake news. They love Trump more than Americans do. Americans don't get it. They actually love this guy, especially Africans. The African, it's not like the black culture in America. Actual African culture totally gets Trump. It's like, oh, I wish we had a leader like that. Oh, that's, I wish we had a leader like that. They're fascinated by him because he gets stuff done. Media, arts, business. You know Hollywood, you know fake news, you know what's going on with the business realm. You know Wall Street with their diversity, equity, inclusion board. By the way, do you know that the left is so strategic? They have an organization I found out about. I can't get Christians to catch this stuff. They have an organization that vets board members for corporations in Wall Street. So here's what you do. You set up your Democrat company that has all these credentialed HR professionals who are going to find the ideal pick for your Hewlett-Packard board or your Apple board or your whatever board. And there are two agencies in New York City that do the headhunting to find qualified, vetted board members who carry influence and cachet with them coming in to complement your board. And they send you the resumes of who you really need to be considering for your board. And it's run by the left, so they populate you with all progressives. You think for a moment conservatives or Christians or Republicans would ever get smart and go, why don't we have an organization that vets people, that we actually get constitutional scholars, that we get actual Christian lawyers or Alliance Defending Freedom educated or Regent University educated? When I say it's not rocket science, getting taken over as a nation happens when you're naive and trust the system is honest and doesn't need your engagement. That's my point. So anyway, here's what I'm saying. The left won't have the patience to listen to my little sermon, but I'm simply saying they've taken the top of all seven mountains. They did it. And they're worried that Christian nationalists and dominionists are other. We're the only thing that can preserve those institutions from suicide. Because what they're teaching is self-destructive to those institutions. You can't sustain a workforce. You're watching the doors blowing off of airlines. I'll say the quiet part out loud. How much of that chain of custody of process is because incompetent people were hired because they fit the right religious or sexual preference category for the left? So instead of getting somebody that can actually put rivets in properly, they hired somebody that wanted the job for $35 an hour and gave it to them. And they can't do the job because they're not the most competent person to do that operation. That's what diversity gets you. Wait till it gets into the flight tower. Wait until you start having crashes on the runway because of errors in the tower. Then you go back and you watch how the media will hide the name and the identity of who that person is. If they ever had a MAGA hat on, they'd be front page. Actually, I need to stop at some point. Our speakers are all meant to kind of like stir up this conversation. It's you can't have it in church because it's way too political. It's like the reason why I can't get a radio station. I got to figure out where Charlie Kirk and the other guys go, quit using an excuse. But here's what they tell me. Lance, the problem is you're too biblical for the secular audience. You're too dang political for the Christian audience. It's kind of hard to figure out exactly where to put you. So, I don't know where else to go. But I do have to, I got a countdown clock here. And here's what I want. Do reset. I need a reset. I'm telling you, I just want to say this, because you're the only people that get it. They're freaking out over this thing called Christian nationalism, and they're trying to make it what it isn't. They're trying to make it sound like a bunch of yahoos that want to impose. Do you ever see that scene in Nacho Libre? How many of you have ever seen Nacho Libre? It's a stupid movie. But I wish I had that scene. I'll get it for other Courage tours. It's where Jack Black is trying to figure out why they're losing their wrestling matches all the time. And he realizes it's because the other guy he's wrestling with refuses to be a Christian. He insists on science. And so he has never been baptized. And so he's thinking about why they're losing, and he has a bowl of water, and he walks up to him, and he says, could it be because, he puts his hand in the back of his head, you have not been baptized, and he drives his head in, like that. And I swear, the left thinks we're going to force everybody to be baptized. Baptized. That's how delirious they are in understanding. So I have I hate the cold opens. You ever watch cold opens like with Bannon and with these shows? Because they make you watch Rachel Maddow, who I will never watch, or CNN or MSNBC. And it's like, oh, God, stop, stop. And it's torture. But he makes you watch because you have to see what's feeding the other side. You have to see the diet they're on. So if we're going to have a proper answer for this, we have to know exactly what kind of a what it is that they're devouring. But I saw this great ad. Do you have the Trump ad? Now, mind you, I'm not promoting Trump. I'm just pointing out how advertisement works in politics. I'm clarifying. This isn't about trying to promote Trump. But you have that one about violence, about the violent Democrats? Tell me when you got it. Working with my production staff over there. They need volume. Turn it up.
Uprisings all over the country, maybe there will be. That you cannot be civil with a political party that wants to destroy what you stand for, what you care about.
If you see anybody from that cabinet in a restaurant, in a department store, at a gasoline station, you get out and you create a crowd.
All right, how about we don't do the video? Hold the video, high price video team. Practice with that one when nobody's here this afternoon. And I'll try it later. I'll try it tomorrow. Anyway, what you have is scene after scene of the calling for violence, for violence, for violence, for violence. Meanwhile, what I'm not going to play for you is another video right now, which is CNN meeting with three reverends to discuss the problem of Christian nationalism. Because they want to make the peace of, I just did like this interview with the Washington Post recently. I said, let me tell you my experience with violence with Christian nationalism. I went to the Trump inauguration in 2016, because my wife was going to have her hips replaced, and we needed to be, we're walking in snow. A businessman got me a limousine. Thank you for the limousine. I get the limousine. I go up to the inauguration. And when I go to the inauguration, I get out of the vehicle, and as I get out of the vehicle, Antifa comes around the corner. They have total neighborhoods blocked off for destruction. They have big orange barriers where you weren't allowed to go. They kept the pedestrians away from the streets that the left was allowed to rage on. There were no police on those streets. And so next thing I know, I'm walking up steps, and Jim Garlow says to me, "Hey, Lance, isn't that your limo?" And I go and see this big plasma screen TV, and there's my limo being firebombed. I had just walked out of it, and they came around the corner and firebombed the limo while I'm walking up the side. I said, "Oh, my gosh, it is." And there's my driver I see getting out, like injured, with a brick through the window. Then Antifa does their Antifa little signal on the thing, throw another firebomb. There it is on the cover of Time magazine, and you see this bellowing flames coming out of a limousine. What was that all about? That was my limo. So then I go over to the Christian inauguration. This is kind of like the second class inauguration. The big donors and everything go to the official one. Christians have their own breakfast. But it's nice. Jonathan Kahn is there. Some friends of mine are there. And so we're all in lines in these nice little zigzag formations, all in line. And I'm looking. I just come from limo burning, Antifa on the streets, to the Christians who are like sheep singing. And I'm looking. I'm saying, what a contrast. The nice little sheepies over here singing and orderly in their little zigzag Disney line, waiting to go into their breakfast in their separate meeting of Christian inauguration breakfast, which won't have a single real politician there for the most part. But we're happy. We're all participating in our own way. And I said, what a beautiful contrast. To the left, we're the people on the street that are burning things down and blowing things, except we never burn things down and blow them up. They do. And I get tired of that narrative. So I told the Washington Post, I might be a little bit like, triggered by this conversation. But you see, we're not the party of violence. We're the party of excessive docility. Our greatest danger is being overly civil. Because you think it's a Christian virtue. And the devil told you that you actually do the turning of the other cheek at the wrong time. Here's a thought. Just take this for what it is. The Apostle Paul gets slapped. Holy Ghost filled Apostle Paul in church by the high priest's servant. And he goes, "You whitewashed wall, do you sit as a judge over me according to the word of God? And yet contrary to the word of God, you order me slapped?" Boom, he just pushed it back right there in the church. "You whitewash, you hypocrite." And then a guy goes, "Hey, that's the high priest you just said that to." He goes, "Huh? Oh, I didn't recognize him." He looks around, he says, "Well, it is also written, thou shalt not speak evil of a ruler of thy people." He's making sure everybody knows he observes the word of God, but he got his rebuke in first. Just remember that. When Elymas the sorcerer was contradicting and blaspheming everything that Paul was saying on his first missionary trip, ironically, he gets hands laid on him in Antioch. He goes off with Barnabas on his first missionary trip. He's trying to behave himself. He goes to a politician of all things. He goes to a politician on his first missionary trip. And he's talking to the Roman proconsul, who is in a political office, who has a senior consultant from one of the consulting firms in Washington, who starts manifesting demons the moment Paul starts talking about God, Jesus, and the resurrection and what God's doing. And he starts contradicting, "You don't know what you're talking about," and blasphemy, "Yeah, that, blank, 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 anybody." The Apostle Paul, who wrote the love chapter, he wasn't being patient and kind. He wasn't turning the other cheek. You got to get your Bible timing right. He turns around and says, "Oh, full of all subtlety and mischief, you son of the devil. Do you not stop perverting the straight paths of the Lord, and behold, the hand of God is on you right now, and you're going to be blind for a season." And immediately a mist of darkness fell upon his eyes, and the man went around, groping around, looking for someone to lean him by the hand. And the proconsul, the Bible says, was astonished at the Bible teaching of Paul. You want to have someone astonished at your doctrine? Start moving in that. Now, I'm not saying this is all the time. Of course, you've got the You've got the other side of it. What I'm saying is we only focus on one, and we keep thinking that our role is to just be kind of like never stand up. And that is a weakness. Rise, Peter, kill and eat. Get involved with the process. Push back. Learn the arguments of the Spirit that work. Raise your voice. There's an audience listening, and they need to see boldness and they need to hear clarity. Does that make sense to you? Well, all right. My schedule here is slightly disrupted. Let me ask you, who's on my team down here helping give me instruction? Are we doing Pastor Shirley next? Was that it? Or are we doing Brother Jensen Franklin? Pastor Franklin. We have very few in our ranks that I could point to as senior pastors who were willing to take the hits for their affiliation with Donald Trump and for the truth. We have some, but there are some that had to pay a higher price than others. And I really admire it when people make those big sacrifices. Pastor Jensen Franklin, a senior pastor of Free Chapel. It's a multi-campus church with a global reach. He's got he's on Real America's Voice. I've been watching him on Sunday mornings because he's a voice to America. That's what I love about people like this. They are a voice of awakening to America, and he's never lost that sweet, and he would not do a sermon like I just did, because he's a man of God who actually kind of has the fruit of the Spirit pours out of him. And so even if you try, how he can have enemies amazes me, but I guarantee he's got them. Even Jesus had enemies, but this man, he flows in the grace of God, and yet he is uncompromising in his clarity and in his conviction. That's why it's a great privilege to be able to have him come here to our Courage Tour, for our first official Courage Tour gathering in the great state of Georgia. Would you please welcome Pastor Jensen Franklin.
Thank you, my friend.
Hallelujah. Lift up a shout for the man of God, for the Spirit of God. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You may be seated. You're very kind. It's an honor to be here today with Lance and his team and all that's going on with the Courage Tour. And I don't know Lance that well. We're getting to know one another, but everything that I hear about him is he's a fighter. He's a man who stands for the Word of God and for this nation and puts it all on the line. And I thank God for that, don't you? I really, really do. I have been married 36 years to my wife, Charisse, and I got up this morning and forgot my wedding ring, but we are still married, and it's bugging me. There's something about it ought to be there. Amen. And but anyhow, I'm thinking about her for some reason right now. Delighted to be here. If you have a Bible, you can open it with me for a few moments. I'm going to go to the book of 2 Kings. I'm going to go to 2 Kings chapter 9. Going back and forth on two different messages. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 12 first, and then we'll end up there maybe if we have time. I want to talk to you about why it's so important to stand and how to stand, how to be unshakable, how to be unmovable as a people that are in the kind of environment that we're in. I pastor a church called Free Chapel. It's up the road. We've got campuses, 8 campuses here in the Atlanta area and across the nation. And when President Trump asked me to serve on his executive board, I went to New York City and I went into his skyscraper office and We met with the presidents, a handful of us there, and I had no intentions of being a part of anything that he was doing. Not that I didn't like him, I liked him. He's a dreamer. I like people that are visionaries. I like dreamers that inspire me. And not all of them are Christians. And I love the fact that he didn't pretend to be something he wasn't. And I was there, and Paula was there, and Jan Crouch was there, and Ken Copeland was there, and Jack Graham was there, and James Dobson was there, and I'm leaving out two or three others. And my son Drake, who is somewhere in here, I brought him with me. Now he works for America First Policy Institute in Washington, D.C. He was there. You were there. Yes, my dear friend, my mind's not on you right now, but I love you. He's a great man right there. And he said something that messed me up after he talked. Mostly he listened. A lot of people don't understand that President Trump listens to the people. If he asks you for a meeting, he will sit and he'll talk for a few minutes and then he'll go around the room and he'll want to hear what you've got to say about it. And if you don't have much to say or something stupid, he'll talk over you. I've watched him long enough. I've learned, I know his reaction. But what I've learned about the man is when you speak truth, even if he doesn't know that it's in the Bible, when you speak truth, he bends toward truth. He bends toward it. I've watched it over and over and over. And so, to make a long story short, he challenged us. He looked at all of us religious leaders, so-called, and he said, you people don't get together for nothing. And we're looking at each other, and we've never been in the same room together, even though all of us have been in the ministry for decades. And he says, their group gets together, but you Christians don't get together. You have the largest voting bloc in the nation, and you don't get together for anything. We no longer have the luxury of disunity. When the President of the United States decrees Easter Sunday, Trans Day recognition, we don't have the luxury of disunity. I don't have to agree with you on everything. If you believe in Jesus, if you believe in the cross, if you believe the Bible is the Word of God, I can come to some place of agreement and say we need to fight for this nation together. Together. There's a verse in Hebrews 12 that says, in verse 27, and this word yet once more signifieth the removing of things that are shaken as of things that are made, and those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore we receive a kingdom that cannot be moved. It cannot be shaken. We serve a God now with reverence and godly fear, for our God is a consuming fire. He said everything that can be shaken is going to be shaken so that that which is unshakable will stand. That's the time that we're living in right now prophetically. Everything that we see and have believed in and loved about our nation is being shaken. And I want to just speak to you for a few moments. I've got 23 minutes and I intend to use all 23. But I want to speak to you, since I'm here, I'm going to preach. And I want to speak to you about structure matters. Structure matters. When you walk into a big building like this and you see the seats and the lights and all this cameras and these screens and all that, that's what you think, but there's the structure that holds the whole thing up. We see the exterior, but structure matters. And not too long ago, I heard something that caught my ear on a podcast I was listening to about building. And this person who is an expert in building said that when they build storm shelters, meaning buildings that are constructed with the storm in mind, that people's lives will rely upon whether or not their families live or die if they can get to that storm shelter. He said, when they build it, they do not use air nail guns. They're not allowed to in the code. If it is going to be a certified storm shelter, you can't use the air nail guns. You have to use the old-fashioned hammer and nail. You can't just pop, 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 pop some things. Now, there's nothing wrong with an air nail gun, but what they found out is there's something in the pounding and the hammer blows and the time that the wood is developing at, between the punches and the hits and the pounding, that somehow it makes it a little bit stronger. We live in an air nail gun society. We want to build a marriage. We know more. It takes you 5 minutes to get a marriage license. And we want to pop, 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 nail gun, nail it real quick. We want to do churches like that. Pop, 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 and we got a church. But if you're building a storm shelter, if you're building something that's going to withstand the attacks, we are not building a nation that'll be here, should the Lord tarry, for a year. We want our nation that will be here for our children and our children's children. We don't need to allow the lies of the enemy to come in and pop, 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 and build a nation that will collapse as soon as the storms come. You can build it temporarily, or you can build it for the long haul. We don't need new gadgets. We don't need a new constitution. We don't need to add on to the Supreme Court just because they don't agree with how we feel. When this system has worked for generation after generation, we don't need our judicial system torn to pieces and redone, and criminals not held to the law, the letter of the law. This is messing with the structure. We don't need our educational systems teaching our children to choose their gender. This is messing with the structure. The structure is what holds everything up. Your bones to your body is the structure of your body. And I don't care how pretty you look on the outside, if I take out one of the bones on your leg, that pretty leg's going to collapse. We as a society and as a nation are messing with the structure that has made America great. And it may take a little longer, but we're not here to curse the darkness only and say amen to things that we agree with when we watch Fox News. But we're here to turn on the light. We're here to say we're of a kingdom that cannot be shaken. We got to have courage and boldness like we've never had to stand for what is right. What's wrong with an air nail, Pastor? Nothing's wrong with it. But you don't build a church real fast. And you don't build a family real fast. And you don't build a nation real fast. When you're building something, when it gets rough outside, that will stand. A good structure will protect you. And the one who built the church, the carpenter's son, said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. That's why you ought to get some courage. Because our founder said, what I'm building, I'm not doing with an air nail gun. I'm doing it with a hammer and a nail and two beams. And I promise you, when I get nailed up on that cross, I don't care what hell brings against your marriage, your family, your nation, and whatever state you live in, what I build is stronger and unshakable. I just need people to hold up that cross and stand and get vocal and get loud and get up and take a stand for what is right. Structure matters. And if you're building the right thing, is strong. I don't care how powerful they look. I don't care if they've got George Soros on their side. I don't care how much money they've got. What we've got, that's pop, 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 pop. What we've got is rock solid. And he said, if you build the house on the rock, the storm can't take it out. Somebody take a praise break right now. You know, professionals, and that's the problem, we got too many professionals in the pulpit. I am not a professional pastor. I am not a professional preacher. This is not a profession. This is not a job. And we are not for hire. And the reason that America is going the route that it's going is the pulpit's fault, in my opinion. And I'm one of them, and I love my pastor friends. But we got a whole generation of young preachers who are pop, 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 nail gun preachers. And it sounds good and it feels good, but it's not going to keep you when your baby's on drugs. It's not going to keep you when your marriage is in trouble. It's not going to keep you when you're going through the fire and you get a report from the doctor. You better have something that is solid and unshakable, and that's what you get from knowing the truth of God's word and standing on it. Now, if you can't give me a Pentecostal amen, I'll take a Baptist nod. I'll take a Presbyterian raised eyebrow right now. I'll take a Catholic crucifix, but let everything that hath breath praise ye the Lord. You know, professionals built the Titanic and it sunk. We got a lot of professional preachers who are worried about Brother Big Bucks more than they're worried about the man on the throne who said, I called you and I want you to have a sermon when you walk to that pulpit like a fire shut up in your bones. Don't you get up like a professional, because professionals built the Titanic and it sunk, but amateurs built the ark. And the only difference between the two was who you get your directions from. And we've got our directions. I'm going to build my family on the Ten Commandments. They can take it out of the courthouse, but they can't take it out of my house and out of my schools. I'm going to build my life on the Word of God, and I'm not depending on D.C. to have a prayer meeting. I don't have a right to talk about D.C. if I don't have any prayer in my own house. When the rain comes, you'll stand. We're not building the Tower of Babel. Boy, it went up. It was impressive. It's impressive. It looks like they're taking over the world. It looks like the false religions are taking over the world. Pop, 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 pop. Higher and higher and bigger, and they won this election and won that election. And this evil people. We're not even talking about left and right. We're not talking about Republicans and Democrats anymore. We're talking about absolute spirit of Antichrist, evil, demonic, messed up, mutilating children's bodies, cutting up 12-year-old girls, taking their breasts off, cutting the genitals off of boys at the age of 8, letting them decide, giving them pubic blockers and messing with the structure of their very being. And the church is silent? And the church, you can't speak up for that? You can't say that's evil, that's wrong.
You read the story of Sodom and Gomorrah when they were taken over. The Bible said that when the angels went to, in Genesis 18, when the angels went to Lot's house, you remember the story? To tell him and his family to get out of there. And the Bible said that the gay community, the transvestites, and the pedophiles. The Bible, how do you know that? Because the Bible said young and old. Read it. They gathered outside, young and old, because the older were sexually abusing the younger. We're seeing a plague of it. And they came to take those two and sexually abuse them out in the streets. And they were pounding on the door. And do you know where the Bible said that Lot was when he goes to Sodom and Gomorrah? Sitting at the gate. You know where Eli the high priest was when the Ark of the Covenant was stolen by the Philistines and taken? The glory, the prosperity, the blessing of God on the nation was dependent upon that God box. And do you know where he was? The Bible said he was sitting in his chair. The church has sit down. And as the pulpit goes, the nation goes. And then if the preachers don't take a stand, it's because the congregation is sitting out there saying, like they did when Jesus walked in the tabernacle in the synagogue. The Bible said it never happened before, but somebody demon-possessed sitting in the congregation said, "Leave us alone. We don't want to take a stand. Let's just be nicey-nicey." And I'm a nice guy. I'm a nice preacher. But I can't be silent. When you start messing with the structure of everything that's good and everything that's pure and everything that's godly and everything that's right, we've got to take a stand. The Tower of Babel fell. But the church still stands. You know, they told me that my church, some did, that if you take a stand, and you know, I stand with the Word of God. If I'm with Trump, I tell him how I feel. I'm pro-life. I told him how I felt about the latest little deal. But I'm not the president, he is. But I thank God that there is a man who's willing to have voices at his table, and 99% of the time he listens. I'd rather have that than somebody who says, "Kill the babies on their birthday, give them a birthday abortion right up to 9 months, or take a few hours and decide while you lay them in a pan." That's messing with the structure of a whole society. And you can't just do that. You can't mess with the structure. I don't mean to sound mean. Do I sound mean? No. They told me if you take a stand, and we did. We lost hundreds of people. We lost hundreds. And what did you do? I just kept standing. I just kept preaching. I didn't preach Donald Trump. I didn't preach Republican Party. I preached Jesus. I preached the Word of God. I preached what the Bible says about life. I preached pro-Israel, pro-life, pro-religious freedom, pro-Bible, Bible. The Bible says, the Bible says, the Bible says. That's what I preach. And we lost hundreds. We lost hundreds. And President Trump on Easter Sunday, one Sunday during the pandemic, said, "I'm going to watch Jensen Franklin on Twitter." I was flying from the West Coast on Delta Airlines flying back to Georgia. And I didn't have Wi-Fi. And I think I fell asleep, so I didn't check my phone. And when I landed, he said, I'm going to watch Jensen Franklin at Free Chapel on Sunday morning. I invite y'all, if you need some hope, I invite y'all to do the same. And you know when you hit the runway, and your phone goes bing, 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 bing. Well, my phone blew up. And I didn't even know that he had done it. I didn't even know that he had put, and oh my God. And the next day, listen to this. So I preached that Sunday morning, and I greeted the president and all of that. They came in, thank God. They sent from his people a thing to come in and reinforce. They got with my team and worked all day Saturday to reinforce our internet capabilities. And I mean, we're a media ministry. I thought we were ready for it. We had over 1.2 million people live. I preached to more people on that morning than I'd ever preached in my whole ministry. Oh, it gets better than that. And some of them big money people left too. But there was somebody watching in another state. And they said, this is what they told me. They said, the only reason we are now, and these people have given tens of millions of dollars to our ministry since then, since 2020. They said the only reason we watched was because anybody that Donald Trump wanted to watch. We said, we've got to see who that is. Oh, come on here. Come on here. If you get some courage, Pastor, God will pay your bills. We're debt free. We owe nothing to nobody. If you get some courage, God will provide. If you get some courage, God will bless you, businessman. But you got to stand for what is right. I believe all that blessing was waiting on my obedience. So I told Donald Trump one time, I shook his hand, I said, you're my number one financial supporter and you don't even know. He looked at me so strange, I said, I'll tell you about it sometime. Oh, hallelujah. I love the Lord. Church, we don't have to fear. My God will supply all our needs according to his riches and glory. I need 100 people to get up on your feet and give God some praise if you believe that structure matters. I think I blew the system up. Hallelujah. I'm done. You know, structure matters. When I think about America, we've lost a lot the last 4 years. I mean, it's serious. It's serious as a heart attack. But as long as you've got the structure, when God is about to do something great, he looks for structure. That's why when he created Adam from the dust of the earth, he put him to sleep, opened up his side, and he was about to form woman, reached in and pulled a rib out of Adam's side and formed woman, and he put Adam to sleep because he didn't care about his opinion. Come on. Didn't want it. And he formed woman. And marriage started right there. That's the structure for marriage. What God, and he looked up and he said, bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. And it was a male and it was a female. That's God's structure. I guess I shouldn't say, but I am at a courage tour. But I know that there are
people who are gay that are sweet people and kind people and wonderful, nice people. There's no question about that. Let's come on, say amen. There's no doubt. And then there are others who are very deviant, just like heterosexuals. There's a lot of adulterers and liars and people hooked on porn and all kinds of stuff going on. So it's no different. We're just, they say, I was born this way. That's why you need to be born again. I was born a liar, an adulterer, a thief, no good for nothing, but I got born again. And you know what he did? Like he did Jacob, he pulled my structure. He messed my hip up and changed my walk. And I used to walk one way, but now I walk like this because that's what he does. He regenerates our structure. Blood comes from the bone marrow. When you mess with the structure, you cut off the blood. I'm almost done. But when I think about children being adopted and growing up, they don't have a mother's love or they don't have a father's love, whether through divorce or even adoption now by couples of same sex. I'm not saying they can't give that child love, but there's something about that that we're messing with the structure of the home and the family. It's very, very, very serious. So what's the answer? We've got to get back to the fact that when Jesus hung on the cross, they broke the man's knees, the thief on the left. He represented Satan because he said the same words that Satan said in the wilderness. If you are the Son of God, he represents Satan falling from heaven. The thief on the other side, they broke his legs because he failed a sin. He was a thief. He's the thief that stole heaven. Prayed a 9-word prayer. Boom, you're in. But they went to break the structure, the legs of Jesus. But he had already said it was finished. And there was a prophecy in Exodus that said, of the Passover lamb, not one bone shall be broken. Because if God's going to resurrect something, he has to have the proper structure. And I close with this. So Ezekiel 37 said, and I was taken to a valley of dry bones. Dry bones. That's really all we've got. And they were scattered. Sounds like the body of Christ. Scattered and dry. But we are not to be a bunch of pessimistic, negative people. We've got enough negaholics in the church. We don't need any more. Come on. We are to stand up and prophesy to the dry, dead bones. And he said, all of a sudden, the structure was still there. It may be scattered. It may be broken. It may be, as long as we've got the church still here, it hasn't been raptured. That means revival. The wind can blow. And he said, they stood up on their feet like a mighty army, and resurrection was attracted to structure. Get up on your feet with me in closing and throw up your hands and say, God, we prophesy to America. Live, hallelujah, live again. We prophesy to the church. Live, we prophesy to dreams and visions and a new generation that is doped up and messed up. Live in the name of Jesus. We receive by faith. We receive by faith. The Spirit to prophesy. And become a mighty army. And it would do good for the United Nations to hear that about Israel, because that's Israel after 1948. And they're not a poor, pitiful, skinny, Holocaust-looking people. God said, when I raise them up,
If you mess with them, you're messing with a mighty army. And that includes America. That includes our leaders. Our leaders better stand with Israel, or the walls, the hedges go down on America. Don't mess with that structure. It's a connection in the spirit between Israel and America. And the closer and stronger and more support we give to Israel, the more God's favor and blessing comes upon our lives, our families, and our nation. I love you. Praise the Lord. Let's lift our hands. Lord, we give you this nation. We thank you for Pastor Lance. Lay your hand on him and his movement. Give him great success across the land. And Lord, use us all. Help us not to be silent. Say this: I will not be quiet. I will stand up. I will get involved. I am the one. This is the place. And now is the time. God bless you.